Several hundred million years ago, great continental rifts and powerful volcanic eruptions helped to create the Atlantic Ocean. Journey across 10,000 miles of this vast sea on an odyssey of discovery, revealing for the first time some of the mysterious life inhabiting its depths.
Funding for the Atlantic Realm is provided by Keebler, helping to make your television enjoyment uncommonly good.
Before the North Atlantic was born, the warmth of the sun nurtured the life that had evolved in the cradle of ancient oceans. These seas and the continents they defined formed a pattern vastly different from today's geography. But as the long, slow ballet of evolution picked up rhythm, the architecture of the planet was to change as well. Between the continents, oceans opened and closed, offering new challenges to life that stepped onto land and lifted into the air. Of these challenges, the North and South Atlantic are the most recent, and they are still slowly growing wider. To explore an ocean is also to voyage back in time, searching for clues to the origin of this vast submarine world. Rising from the seafloor are mountains of Himalayan stature, on whose slopes the sun will never shine, and creatures stranger than any seafarer's extravagant myth. Our search will lead not only into this inner space, but to the remarkable islands of the North and South Atlantic, strung out down the length of these oceans. Were it not for the deep abyss of the ocean floor, all land would be hidden by one great sea. As it is, there's hardly enough Earth to justify the planet's name. But between the drifting, diverging continents and barely visible from space are islands like jewels set in the sea. To them in time came life, climbing aboard like the animals entering the Ark. And in the patterns of life on those islands can be read the history of the Atlantic. Our story is almost 200 million years old. Travel back through that time, and we review the drifting journeys the jostling continents undertook either side of the oceans that were to form between them. 165 million years ago, the infant North Atlantic was a long, narrow waterway, perhaps at first fresh, fed by rain and rivers, but soon to be soured by saltier seas that would enter it. Then, pterosaurs glided over the young ocean, and giant reptiles lazed in its shallows. Thank you. ruffled by hot, humid winds held in this seaway between the continental shores, the waters became increasingly salt as the sun pulled vapor from their surface. They became a bitter sea, where some life was choked by the brine, bleached by the sun. The salt-spangled shores and the thick waters spreading those deposits were a challenge to life. Few plants and animals could survive such a testing ground. But those that did, although few in kind, were profuse in number. Bacteria and algae tinted the young Atlantic and multiplied into a broth. It nourished brine shrimp and brine flies. They, in turn, flourished and burgeoned in uncountable millions. Much later, the legacy of this explosion of marine life has been inherited by us as oil. The places where these specialized flies still thrive today mirror that now distant world. Yet the processes that began to open the Atlantic then are still awesomely at work today. Lava erupts through the ocean crust, along the rift that opens as the continents drift apart. As the pressure eases on the superheated plastic mantle of the Earth deep below, it liquefies into molten magma and erupts into the widening abyss. Water pressure suppresses the explosive volcanic force, and the lava solidifies into pillows of basalt, building the seafloor higher. Finally, in places, it allowed life to anchor, grow, and flower as reefs of sediment and coral built up to form the Bahamas of today. Nutritious waters and sunlight feed the single-celled algae within the corals that build the carbonate reefs. From them, parrotfish rasp a meal. The undigested residue is returned to the reef to become the fine coral sand that wafts in the tidal breeze. These unusual formations of sediment, called stromatolites, are also the work of algae. They were present on that young North Atlantic seafloor when the Bahamas were born. The oxygen they yield was swept into the undersea storms and gales that began to mix the new cocktail of the forming ocean and the atmosphere above it. There's a limit to the amount of calcium carbonate that warm subtropical water can dissolve, so the vast bulk remains as deep sediments and as drifting fragments and grains. These products of life were heaped by time and the restless waves into islands that, as today, either lay ready for plants and animals to colonize by chance or disappear overnight, the chance denied. After the dinosaurs and other large reptiles became extinct, and flying reptiles were gone, birds eventually inherited this subtropical desolation. The Bahamian flamingo is often called desolation's child. They have the same specialized ability as their ancestors to use these extraordinary beaks to pump and filter the wealth of shrimp and other small life from the concentrated brine. These large, shallow salinas, with their smelly, sticky muds, are thought to be very much like the prehistoric shores of the North Atlantic when it was in the making. These islands and the life they support drifted west with the nearby North American continent at a rate about as fast as your fingernails grow. The Bahama banks are now thousands of miles from where they began to form. They've gathered a wealth of plants, a transformation started by those land builders of the tropics, mangroves. Mangroves become as much a forest under the sea as above, tolerating the heat and salt of the island lagoons. Their growth and decay nourishes these quiet waters, which have become an enchanted forest and a nursery for young fish. This trunk fish, when older, will move from here to hunt on the reefs. And this young houndfish will spend its adult life hunting just beneath the waves. Young barracudas, also predators of the open ocean, pass their formative years relatively safe behind this nursery's bars. For them, too, it's both haven and pantry. But there are other young monsters here that stalk the enchanted forest's shadows. Lemon sharks, before whose speed and predatory purpose young fish scatter. The tranquility of this shallow lagoon away from the open ocean has been sought out by an adult female lemon shark. She's been pregnant for a year and is about to give birth. Her pups will be born fully developed, and they'll be safer here because out on the reef, they would themselves be prey to larger sharks. A couple of remoras, or shark suckers, look for parasites on her rough skin. Pups are now active within her. She's completed the first part of her maternal duties. Now she rests in the seagrass as though tamed. Now, too, comes a moment that has seldom been seen in the wild. The first pup struggles out. Tail first, two more of her 11 pups make their Atlantic debut. The remoras have switched their attention to scavenging the membranes from the births, the umbilical cords, and the kind of placenta that these ancient and successful predators evolved over millions of years. Although she's taken instinctive care to liberate her young in the safety of the lagoon, even she may eat her own pups. Some 20 females will use the lagoon each May, so there can be 200 or more lemon sharks in these shallows. But only the youngest will remain here, learning to hunt for 3 years before venturing to the outer reef, and in time, the open ocean around the Bahamas. the Bahama Islands stand not solely on columns of limestone thousands of feet high, but on the original volcanic basement formed when the North Atlantic first opened. In the early days of their formation, they may have looked like this nearby atoll. Today, the North Atlantic is, on average, 2.5 miles deep and over 3,000 miles wide, and still getting wider. Could the ocean be removed and the sea floor exposed? The most striking feature revealed would be part of the longest mountain range in the world. It marks the spreading ridge from which ocean floor is still being formed, and on the ridge itself sit some of the youngest islands in the Atlantic, and the land of ice and fire itself, Iceland. Ever since it broke the surface, Iceland has been a land on the boil. Iceland is a natural cauldron, trembling above the fires of the earth, and warmed by heat from the rift that bisects it as Europe and America continue to part company. The landscape's dramatically stark beauty holds a special fascination for geologists, for this land is a replica of the spreading ridge on the sea floor, but above the sea. Solidified lava is one of the raw materials of the earth. Forged in fire, it's sterile, but ready to accept the life that pioneers its surface. Below, the Atlantic marine organisms would exploit this new territory, but here, laid bare to the winds of the air, mosses, lichens, and herbs have taken hold along this broad and rolling swath of basalt that is part of the mid-Atlantic ridge. Rivers from nearby glaciers flow into the deep faults and crevices of this new lava. It's a reminder of how fresh water, and then the sea, occupied the opening North Atlantic basin that formed when the continents began to part. The western shores of this lake are really part of North America. Its eastern shores belong to Europe. Its waters have long been a meeting place for birds of both continents. Each summer, red-necked phalaropes up from Africa twirl on this shallow, freshwater lake, which lies through an accident of nature where there ought to be 1,000 fathoms of salt water. There are Americans here as well, harlequin ducks, now residents of Iceland. They winter at the coast, but fly upriver each spring to find these inland torrents and lakes. Americans as well are these black fly larvae, food for the harlequins. Europe's greatest concentration of breeding ducks, of 14 or so different kinds, exploits this lake of midges and its rivers' fresh water, cradled in the ocean's crust. North Atlantic's newest island appeared here in November 1963, close to where the mid-Atlantic ridge steps out of the sea onto the land. The Icelanders named it Surtsey, after Surtur the fire giant. As the submarine volcano grew in size, it reached the surface, where, unhindered by water pressure, it grew with explosive violence as it battled with the waves. Close by, a similar battle of ocean and fire was lost. This island was soon quenched and disappeared. But still, the fire giant quietly survives, though the cold sea still gnaws at the young cliffs. Surtsey's long-term future is far from assured. This virgin land of shifting ash and sterile lava can only slowly gather its cloak of life. Plants come drifting out of the sea and out of the air. Ocean-going birds find temporary haven, and some have nested. Birds of passage pause. And perhaps from the mud on their feet come other organisms, ferried to this island ark, this youngest of Atlantic outposts. It's a story that in various ways has happened before on the other islands of our Atlantic story. South of Iceland, there lies only water, and those other islands that sprang from the floor of the open ocean. Yet it's hard to be alone on a wide, wide sea. The ancient mariners all looked for and took comfort in the presence of birds at sea. The aptly named Cory Shearwaters, shearing and catching the breeze close to the waves, rely on the ocean providing squid. Shearwaters have come to know that at dusk, the squid migrate to the surface. This is just one of the links forged by evolution between the creatures of the deep and those of us in the ocean of air above. Of all the birds on Earth, seabirds are a very small minority, yet they exist in a variety of kinds. Their success reflects the virtue of the ocean as a provider, a life support system. All these birds need to make landfall at some time in their lives, and a remote oceanic island should offer security and shelter and firm ground on which to nest. This island of the salvages, close to Madeira, is almost 2,000 miles directly south of Iceland and in a warmer Atlantic. Seabirds may well have been the first creatures to live here, even before plants were established. To this day, there are no ground-dwelling animals to plunder the eggs or chicks. It's at dusk that this island comes alive. There are petrels and other shearwaters besides the Corys nesting here. After a day at sea, the parents are full of squid plucked from the ocean. Because the island is small, they won't find any hot air rising to help them up the cliff face. Here, each pair must find its own nest and their single chick, which has waited all day for this moment. A little instinctive encouragement by the chick should result in a release of the Atlantic's bounty. This island, being too small and too low to milk moisture from the winds, is dry and barren. But it offers safety and seclusion to these birds of the ocean. But there are other, larger volcanic islands nearby that have been thrust up from the Atlantic's depths. South of Madeira and the Salvages, among the Canary Islands, is the island of Tenerife, crowned by a volcano that last erupted in 1909. Known as Pico de Teide, it first grew from deep in the ocean to well over 12,000 feet above the sea. Its peak is above the moist northeast trade winds that may well have borne the first chance colonists to this island arc. The shiny, fleshy-leaved rosettes of the variety of house leeks that have colonized these slopes tell of hot days when sunlight must be reflected away and water must be held onto, and cold nights when frost threatens to nip at buds unless concealed. They must all conserve sufficient water to fuel the sudden spurt of growth when they flower in this high volcanic desert. The variety of shapes and colors of these adaptable plants is a common island phenomenon. With no competitors, the first pioneering house leek was able to diversify into every difficult niche. Now selected by nature, each new kind is found only here. The crater, or caldera, of the volcano is home to other striking plants that have evolved only on this island. These spikes of the giant bugloss are man-high. Again, the leaves are rosetted for protection, and the flowers that are hidden in this amazing structure for several years will bloom only once in the lifetime of the plant. Its future will be committed to its scattered seeds. This blossoming is good news for bees that have been able to make this island their home only because there are plants established here that can sustain them. But it's the island that's in control. Its height influences the local climate and dictates which invading plants and animals can coexist high among the lava and the ash, and at times, snow. Resembling a petrified river, the lava of 1798 lies here, challenging life to exploit it. A challenge already met by the canary pines. They are trees that survived somehow by tolerating the fires, droughts, and cold to become another unique feature of Tenerife. Following the canary pines came chaffinches that stayed. They're now quite different from their wind-blown ancestor that made landfall here. Other smaller islands not far away have their own special animals with their own special response to island isolation. This wolf spider has become unusually big. With a body about the length of your thumb, it's now the largest wolf spider in the world, and it seems to have become rather lazy, no longer hunting with the speed and agility of its smaller ancestor. Its prey, a cockroach, is now ambushed instead. The giant spider's island home is small and also dry and hot. But the lower slopes of the larger islands in this archipelago are quite different. North of the Canaries, this is the Portuguese island of Madeira. Its ancient volcanic bulk catches those winds known as the trades.
Hey,
moisture on the wind is trapped by the plants that long ago colonized the bare lava. The fresh water condensed from the salt breezes stimulates the island's life, generating streams and waterfalls, and yet more forest that will gather yet more water from the mists of the sea. Lush forests that cling to the ravines are largely of laurel, a relic of the time in the Ice Age when such laurel forests extended much further south on the nearby continent, as far down as the Sahara and those parallel islands off the West African coast. It's in these inaccessible forest refuges that the laurel pigeon finds sanctuary. This young pigeon is taking its pigeon's milk, a regurgitated gruel of the laurel berries on which they now depend. Only on Madeira and the Canary Islands do laurel forests still exist. The laurel or long-toed pigeons are distinctive island descendants of the European wood pigeons that once crossed the sea to get here and became isolated as their mainland forest home died out. Unlike Madeira, the Canary Islands are close to Africa. Over 1,000 years ago, a colonizer came from there to this gorge on Gran Canaria and changed the pattern of life here. The newcomer found its living space in the ancient lavas that had flowed in natural tubes as the island erupted from the ocean floor below. They were accompanied by other creatures, more animal invaders than ever before in all the island's long history. Their conquest would spell the death of the forest, the exploitation of the island's life, and the transformation of the landscape. The newcomer was mankind, the Guanche people, a warrior race of the Berbers. They are now just a memory on Gran Canaria. Only their tools and weapons and the bones of their sheep and goats tell the story of the sudden change they brought. Not all the island's own animals suffered extinction. This giant lizard is an impressive survivor. It's about a yard long. Great size is a common feature of many island animals. Think of that wolf spider or the giant tortoises of the Galapagos. This product of island evolution must now feed on the prickly pear, a poor legacy of that first human invasion, an alien cactus from South America that has flourished where the forests were cut for fuel. The prickly pear, like people, is a mixed blessing on an island ark. Far south of the Canaries, just below the equator, standing at the gateway to the South Atlantic, is the extremely remote island of Ascension. It has more in common with Surtsey than the Canaries, for it formed close to the volcanically active Mid-Atlantic Ridge. A pinprick on the map At least 900 miles from the nearest land, its massive volcano rises 18,000 feet from the ocean floor. Now its lava fields bake in a searing tropical sun. South Atlantic rollers beat on this barren coast with the energy of the Antarctic storms that set them on their way. What life can this ocean or the air ferry to these inhospitable shores? Countless Sally Lightfoot crabs arrived as tiny floating larvae adrift on the South Equatorial Current. For every one that makes a landfall here, uncounted millions must whirl by on the great gyration of the Atlantic waters. The carcass of a baby turtle that has failed to leave the island on its first journey into the ocean will be picked clean by the tenacious Sally Lightfoots. Many turtles do make a successful exodus from these rugged shores, and in time, return to lay eggs in the volcanic sands of ascension. These animals are part of the age-old natural trade between the South Atlantic and this island. This crab is trying to get out of the sea. It's a land crab and will drown if swept offshore. It had to return to the water to lay its eggs, a link between its origins and the surprising life it leads now on the hot, dry lava fields, even as far inland as the peak of the old volcano. When the equatorial sun is at its zenith, there are no crabs to be seen. Only when it's cooler are they out from their burrows or away from the shade of rocks. Seabirds claimed this island long before the Portuguese blew in on the ocean winds. Boobies and the elegant bosun birds, as mariners named them, thrive in this breeding ground. It's set close to the deep tropical Atlantic waters, from which they manage to make a catch of squid and fish. Fairy terns balance on the hot winds before diving to nests on the steep cliffs of an offshore islet. Every corner of this rock is occupied by seabirds. Above the tern, in the penthouse of this rocky dwelling, boobies present a mass defense by nesting together. The dark, gaunt shape of a frigate bird overhead is a constant threat, but both parent boobies are taking great care of their few eggs. They are a vulnerable investment in the future. Even the ocean can never be relied on to bring sufficient food for all when the chicks have hatched. Seabirds commit themselves to breeding only when sufficient food seems available. There are no seasons here. It's panting weather all year round. Of the two eggs, one at least should hatch. The second egg may be a kind of insurance. There are already chicks in the colony, in fact, fledglings at all stages of growth, because there is no breeding season. The frigate birds are raising young as well, but usually at the expense of other seabirds whose food they steal. They are the parasites of this mixed society, the muggers of this seabird city. This youngster is a pirate in the making. As the young masked boobies grow, feeding them becomes a vigorous encounter. Brown boobies venture further than the masked boobies for their food. They search the open ocean well offshore, and to do so, are equipped for graceful gliding flight that makes maximum use of the air currents and conserves the bird's energy over long distances. Returning to Bosun Bird Island, as the islet is called, both brown boobies and the masked kind that have been fishing inshore must run the gauntlet of the sky-patrolling frigate birds. Sometimes called man-o'-war birds, they are skilled flyers and masters of air piracy. They can grab the tail or wing of a victim, causing the bird to disgorge food, which the agile frigate catches in midair. And they've been seen to hijack each other in the same way. White-breasted birds are young frigates, just taking their first shot along the coast, scavenging whatever catches their attention. Never rest on the water. They would waterlog and drown. They can spend many days far out at sea, perhaps sleeping on the wing. And that's probably how the first frigates came to ascension. Bosun Bird Island stands out, crowned white with guano, the droppings of the seabirds, in striking contrast to the darker cliffs of Ascension. There is guano on these lavas, but now it's weathered and dull with age. Once these now deserted colonies must have made Ascension an extraordinary island of birds. There's an unnatural atmosphere to these cliffs now, a silence that fell soon after the first British sailors and colonists arrived last century. There are still birds in places, wide-awake terns, whose traditional breeding place this is. But these corpses indicate that this is no longer a place of safety. The perimeter of the colony is littered with dead terns. Something is attacking them at night. Only those at the center will have a chance of raising young. Thieves in the night are not the rats that jumped ship here when the island was discovered by the Portuguese, but British cats that in 1815 were set loose and found the plump seabirds more to their liking than the rats they were supposed to control. The cats slaughtered all other seabirds except those that survive on tiny offshore islets such as Bosun Bird. All that's left here are the wide-awake terns, and they've survived because they come here only to breed. When not raising chicks, they are birds of the ocean, on the wing for 9 months until they return here to nest. Some, like this tern, will fall victim this very night to the few cats that have somehow managed to survive between the tern's breeding seasons. The terns and cats have established a natural balance of predator with prey, a living reminder of the legacy of change brought to this island, as it was to the canaries and other island arks by our own kind. In Comfortless Cove, some of the British garrison found the island an unforgiving place. Their task? To defend the ocean approach to another volcanic island 800 miles to the southeast. For there, a very special prisoner was held captive by the Atlantic. The prisoner was Napoleon. His ocean prison, well south of Ascension, was St. Helena, which, along with Tristan da Cunha, is one of the remotest inhabited islands in the world. Perhaps where the Royal Mail ship St. Helena drops anchor today, that same Portuguese explorer first hove to the year after he found Ascension and reefed his sails in what's now Jamestown Harbor. For many years after 1502, this was a secret supply port for the Portuguese in the South Atlantic, a market garden hidden by the ocean. For a brief time, the Dutch had a foothold on this volcano in the ocean. But in 1659, the East India Company took possession. Their coat of arms welcomed the captains of the sailing ships on the trade routes round the Cape of Good Hope or Cape Horn before the days of steam and the Panama Canal took this island off the commercial map, leaving only living reminders of those trading days. Java sparrows from the Indies still stake out the warehouses where once they feasted on the spilt seeds of the spice trade. And Indian minas are echoes of clipper ships taking tea from India to England. Perhaps shipborne around the Horn came ground doves from the New World. And also from America, the blossoms of the black-eyed Susan. St. Helena is still home to several ocean birds. But unlike Ascension Island, here, some live close to people. The stone walls of Jamestown Church, as seen through the eyes of fairy terns, are every bit as hospitable as the lava cliffs around this South Atlantic island that have been used by them for millions of years. With their mascaraed eyes and intimate gestures, it's no wonder they are known as lovebirds. The chicks have very large feet and can safely cling to the most precarious places, waiting for their returning parents. They will have fished the surface of the ocean for a beakful of South Atlantic souri, or skippers. They look so good, it's not easy to know where to start. Or for that matter, where to finish. The chicks grow rapidly. Already, her month-old fledgling has taken to the trees opposite the church. A couple of hours' walk away from sun-drenched Jamestown, the atmosphere is cooler and wetter. Tree ferns and gumwood trees were part of the original forests that colonized the lava. Most of these trees were burnt, grazed, or felled for their timber, leaving bare slopes again. These black cabbage tree seedlings sprouting from compost in the trunks of tree ferns are reminders of how it once was. A South Atlantic Eden that in 300 years has been slowly impoverished, where now, high out of reach of the woodsman's axe, two of the last St. Helena ebony trees cling to this cliff. Old roots of ebony exposed by heavy rains still lie as epitaphs to the vanished glory of those island forests. Long ago, hard won from seeds born here on the wind, or washed ashore after a long journey through the South Atlantic. A world haunted by the wandering albatross. Did cross an albatross, through the fog it came. As if it had been a Christian soul, we hailed it in God's name. It ate the food it ne'er had eat, and round it flew. The ice did split with a thunder fit, the helmsman steered us through. And a good south wind sprang up behind, the albatross did follow. And every day for food or play, came to the mariner's hollow. Folklore of the southern seas, no bird is more famous than these graceful gliders shearing the waves in quest of squid and fish. Albatrosses are strictly South Atlantic birds. Because they have been unable to cross that region of the Atlantic close to the equator, known as the doldrums, where the wind dies and sailing ships are often becalmed. Confined to the South Atlantic, their landfalls must be oceanic islands. This is Tristan da Cunha, and the yellow-nosed albatross comes here to breed. Though the epitome of grace over the water, they are more clumsy over land and on the ground. It probably uses far more energy taking a few steps through the dwarf tree ferns than gliding and soaring for several miles over the waves. After months at sea, they settle into the rituals of courtship on this most isolated inhabited island in the world. An island which, because it is close to the mid-Atlantic ridge, is still growing. This flow of lava erupted violently in 1961. Though only one house was destroyed, the 300 islanders evacuated their homeland. The settlement of Edinburgh, largely built of lava blocks, stood empty for 2 years. In the shadow of the volcano that erupted as the younger South Atlantic opened wider. While the people were exiled, the rockhopper penguins moved closer to the houses, and there they stayed, even when the islanders came back. It was as though the penguins welcomed them back as true islanders, able to live nowhere else. A people apart and at home with the creatures of this remote South Atlantic realm. South Atlantic is an ocean with a character and richness all its own. But its waters are confluent with the older Atlantic north of the equator. And the huge gyration of these southern currents links and mixes the waters of the north with those of all the southern seas around Antarctica. The cold southern waters through which penguins fly are subject to the most profound seasonal change on the planet. A change that increases the saltiness of this ocean's water, which then sinks. And so begins a hidden journey north, sliding beneath the ocean. Rich in oxygen, its circulation acts as a great global lung. From it, the entire ocean, north and south, even the entire world, draws breath. And life is sustained, because here, every year, at the end of the world, the sea freezes over.
An American and a Soviet take a walk in the woods and attempt to solve the differences between their countries through personal understanding. American Playhouse, next at 8 on Channel 10.
Proud to have made the preceding program possible. Keebler, helping to make your television enjoyment uncommonly good.